Hi viewers, hope all is well with you. So we have been doing a series on culturing of microorganisms, and under that today we will be talking about an interesting group of organisms known as anaerobes. So these are organisms that you will be able to isolate from the marshy areas or from swamps or from the ruminant stomach. Or even in a human body, you will get this in the dental specimens or in deep tissue abscesses. So these are the areas where you can isolate anaerobes from. But the culturing methods that we have been talking about till now cannot be applied for anaerobes because they have a very strict requirement of zero oxygen or no oxygen. Even a little bit of oxygen can lead to the death of the organism. So when we try to cultivate these anaerobes, or even when we try to take the sample, the sample collection is done in rubber stoppered collection vials. So those kind of vials are used, and we have anaerobic bags, anaerobic pouches, which are used to store these vials. So basically these organisms have to be handled very carefully, very delicately, so that we don't expose them to any oxygen. So let us look at what is the problem, why are they unable to bear the oxygen concentration in the atmosphere, and how exactly can we grow them, or what are the different methods that can be used. So this is a picture you might have seen on many of the websites. It is a very simple way of showing the oxygen requirements of microorganisms. As you can see here in the tube 1, we have a broth. So every tube is having a broth, and it is just showing or depicting where each type of organism will grow. Now in tube 1, we have the growth of obligate aerobes. These are organisms which are totally dependent on oxygen for their growth. For example, we have Pseudomonas aeruginosa. So such organisms will be found in the topmost layers of any broth culture. Then we have obligate anaerobes, the exact opposite, that is in tube 2, wherein the organisms cannot tolerate even a little bit of oxygen. So they will be found at the bottommost layer of any culture vessel. Then we have facultative anaerobes like Staphylococcus, E. coli, Bacillus. These are organisms which can grow in the presence as well as in the absence of oxygen, but they grow better in the presence. So they are actually aerobic, but they can optionally become anaerobic. Such organisms are called as facultative anaerobes. In tube 4, we have microaerophiles. So these include organisms like Campylobacter, wherein the organism needs oxygen, but not the atmospheric level of oxygen, not 21%. It requires lower concentration of oxygen, maybe 2 to 10%. And finally, we have aerotolerant microbes or aerotolerant anaerobes, which are organisms like Enterococcus faecalis. They do not require oxygen for their growth, but they can grow equally well in the presence as well as the absence of oxygen. So as you can see here, this is a very simple depiction of the requirement of oxygen by every microorganism. Now under these, what we will be focusing upon are the obligate anaerobes, the organisms which cannot tolerate even a little bit of oxygen. Why that happens is, when there is oxygen present, or when you have oxygen in the atmosphere, or when the organism is trying to, you put it in a growth medium which is having oxygen in it, the oxygen will readily accept electrons and get converted into compounds called as, or species called as, the reactive oxygen species. Now these are highly reactive chemical molecules which are basically being formed due to the electron receptivity of oxygen. So oxygen accepts the electrons and forms these reactive oxygen species. Now these are being formed in every cell. If you see any biological system, reactive oxygen species are formed as a natural byproduct of the metabolism, aerobic metabolism. So they are having important roles as well in the cell. We have seen that they have significance to play in the cell signaling, in homeostasis. But the problem is that these reactive oxygen species are always present at low levels, or they are always present at stationary levels. Now where the problem arises is that when we have very high concentration of reactive oxygen species, these being powerful oxidizing agents will start rapidly destroying the cellular constituents. So our cell should have a mechanism by which we can nullify, or we can negate the effect of this reactive oxygen species. So all the organisms which are able to tolerate oxygen possess enzymes which are giving this protection against the oxygen products or against the reactive oxygen species. These reactive oxygen species are the ones which I have listed out over here. Like we have hydrogen peroxide, superoxide anion, hydroxyl radical, singlet oxygen. So these are some of the reactive oxygen species that are being normally produced in any cell that is growing in the presence of oxygen. But such cells which are growing in the presence of oxygen have enzymes like superoxide dismutase and catalase. Now this enzyme is there in all the obligate aerobes. It is there in human beings. It is there in microorganisms which are aerobic. It is there in facultative anaerobes. So these enzymes are helping in the destruction of superoxide anion, that is O2 minus. Here there should be a minus. Please do note that. So we have O2 minus, which is the superoxide anion, and that superoxide anion is being converted into a harmless oxygen. The same way we have H2O2, which is hydrogen peroxide, being broken down by catalase to give us the harmless oxygen. So in both the cases, these reactive oxygen which are being species which are being formed over here, like superoxide anion and the H2O2 or hydrogen peroxide, are being destroyed, are being brought back to a harmless product. Now the other organisms like aerotolerant microbes or we have the microaerophiles, they may lack one of these enzymes. They may have catalase, they may lack superoxide dismutase, but they do have mechanisms to beat the effects of oxygen, or they do have mechanisms to make sure that the reactive oxygen species don't accumulate in the cell. Now the problem is with our anaerobes. These poor anaerobes lack such enzymes, and because of that they get stuck and they cannot be, or they will not be able to tolerate the presence of oxygen. So these anaerobes which I have been talking about include examples like Clostridium species, Bacteroides, Fusobacterium. These are all found as normal flora of the skin and the mucous membranes. They are found in the dead and decaying matter, in ruminants also, in the gut of ruminants. These are normal flora. So these anaerobes are whatever I have listed out over here are all bacteria. So we have methanogens, which are the methane generating bacteria. Most of the fungi are aerobes, that is why I have not listed them over here. Of course, there is a group of fungi called as the Chytridomycota, which are residing in the rumen of the cattle. So those are obligate anaerobes. But other than that, these what are listed out over here are all bacteria. Now, these organisms are important to us because, like I told you earlier, they are found in the gut lining. They may be causing certain infections in our body. So we need to isolate them. We need to learn how to cultivate them, how to grow them, how to handle them. The first thing when we talk about cultivation of anaerobes is the media. Now the media that is used for anaerobes has to be a pre-reduced medium. When we say a pre-reduced medium, like I have shown over here, this is PRAS, which stands for pre-reduced anaerobically sterilized medium. So the pre-reduced medium means to say that that medium has been removed of oxygen or freed of oxygen before we inoculate the organism. That makes sure that there is no free oxygen present dissolved in the medium which may kill our anaerobe. So such pre-reduced media have to be used. To prepare such pre-reduced media, during the preparation of the culture medium, it has to be boiled for some time so that the dissolved oxygen escapes out. And along with that, we can use reducing agents which have been shown over here. So there are several reducing agents that can be used, like we have thioglycolate, cysteine, ascorbic acid. We can use cooked meat. There can be sodium mercaptoacetate. These are some of the reducing agents that can be added to a medium to make sure that the medium is totally free of oxygen. So the reducing agents, what do? They react with the dissolved oxygen and remove it. So we are making sure that not only is the environment oxygen free, but also the medium is oxygen free. Additionally, we can also bubble air that is oxygen free, for example oxygen free nitrogen or oxygen free hydrogen. It can be bubbled through the medium to make sure that no oxygen enters inside and it is completely being maintained under anaerobic conditions. So these are some of the media that have been I have shown over here. This is a pre-reduced blood agar that is shown over here in the first picture. Then we have Robertson's cooked meat broth or cooked meat medium, which is also a very important medium wherein nutrient broth is mixed with beef. And what happens there is that the unsaturated fatty acids in the beef or in the meat use up the oxygen, and thus we are having no oxygen present in the medium. So they auto-oxidate or they use up this oxygen for auto-oxidation. Then we have thioglycolate medium. As you can see here, this is Staphylococcus, which is growing in the topmost layers, whereas Clostridium perfringens is growing in the bottom layers. So these are some examples of organisms or media which can be used to grow anaerobic organisms. One thing to remember is that there are many other media, but we need to make sure that they have to be pre-reduced or they have to be supplemented with a reducing agent. Now, once we use such a media, there are various techniques for growing the anaerobes. The most common technique that is being that has been used is the gas pack jar or the gas pack system. Now, the gas pack jar comes under a group of techniques called as the anaerobic jar. We have other anaerobic jars as well, which are basically specialized anaerobic chambers for the incubation of the organism. So once we inoculate the organism, we do the inoculation in an anaerobic chamber. Once we do the inoculation, instead of keeping the plates or the tubes in the LAF or in the incubator, instead of these two, we use anaerobic chamber for the inoculation and we use anaerobic jar for the incubation. We cannot use a regular incubator. So these anaerobic jars are of different types. We have Brewer's jar, Macintosh jar, and this what I have shown you here is the gas pack system, which are maintaining anaerobic incubation conditions. So the gas pack jar is having certain specialities or unique characteristics because of which it is very popular. One of the first things that the gas pack jar has is it is having a gas generator envelope. Now the gas generator envelope has components in it or chemicals in it, such as sodium borohydride and sodium bicarbonate, which are reacting with water to release hydrogen and carbon dioxide. So before closing the lid, we sprinkle water on the gas generator envelope that is provided. The gas generator envelope has chemicals embedded in it, which generate the hydrogen and carbon dioxide into the atmosphere or into the jar, into the airspace of the jar. The hydrogen, which is now released, will react with oxygen, any residual oxygen that is present within the jar in the presence of palladium. So hydrogen reacts with the oxygen in the jar in presence of palladium that acts as a catalyst and releases water. Now the palladium comes from a catalyst chamber that is attached to the lid of the anaerobic jar or lid of the gas pack jar. Additionally, we have carbon dioxide also being released from the gas generator envelope. This is also very, very good, or it is known to enhance the growth of the anaerobic organisms. Anaerobic organisms thrive better under high carbon dioxide conditions. Along with all this, there is also an indicator strip that is being provided. The indicator strip is an anaerobic indicator strip which is having methylene blue in it. Now, this methylene blue being an indicator will turn colorless when there is no oxygen. So, if we have done that, the entire incubation under the correct conditions, then the strip remains colorless, which means that the experiment has become a success because it has been completely anaerobic. If the strip turns blue in color, it means to say that somewhere there is a leakage or somewhere oxygen has crept in. So this is the feature or this is the characteristic of gas pack jar, that it not only provides us an anaerobic environment for growth, it also helps us to check whether we are actually doing the entire procedure under anaerobic conditions. Then we have the anaerobic chamber, which is helping us to provide an oxygen-free atmosphere to work with the oxygen-sensitive material. So it helps us to do the incubation or inoculation. When we need to introduce the organism into the media, into the pre-reduced medium, we use anaerobic chamber. Now the anaerobic chamber, as you can see, is having a glove box, and the glove box makes sure that we don't come in direct contact with the material that we are going to work with. It is through the glove port that we are going to do all the work inside the chamber. And the chamber is made sure that it is having an atmosphere of hydrogen, carbon dioxide and nitrogen. There is no oxygen within the chamber. There is also a vacuum airlock. That airlock is used to reduce the oxygen levels before we do all the transfer. So whenever something is being moved in, moved out, this vacuum makes sure that no oxygen gets inside. Additionally, we also have one chamber through which we are the pass box through which we transfer all the contents that are required into the chamber. So it is not directly kept inside. We have to move it through this pass box or through this access port, and this makes sure that the entire environment inside the anaerobic chamber always remains free of oxygen. So these are some of the major techniques that are used: anaerobic chamber for doing the inoculation and anaerobic jar for allowing the incubation of anaerobes. We also have certain other methods such as the roll tube method, and we have the pyrogalol method. So roll tube method was developed by Hungot, and Hungot has given this very simple technique, a very primitive technique but very easy to do technique for growth of the anaerobes. So in this method, the medium that is taken is a pre-reduced medium, and then it is boiled for 10 minutes to remove the air. After that, it is cooled and inoculated with the microorganism. Then the tube is rolled between the palms. When we roll the tube between the palm, the inoculum is completely distributed throughout the medium, and then it is allowed to solidify. So after incubation, we will see that the organisms which are anaerobic grow deep within the medium, whereas facultative anaerobes are found throughout, and the aerobes grow on the surface of the medium, as you can see in the picture given here. We also have other methods such as the use of candles or phosphorus sticks, which are burnt in the vessel inside so that completely oxygen can be removed. But it has been seen that this leads to the development of other gases such as carbon monoxide, which can harm our organism. So these methods of using candlesticks or phosphorus sticks are not used these days. We also have a pyrogalol method, as you can see over here. So the pyrogalol method is wherein we prepare the agar slant and then we inoculate the organism that we need to work with. After that, the cotton plug, the top region of the cotton plug, which we call as the flush, is cut off, and the remaining portion is pushed inside the tube. Once it is pushed inside the tube, whatever area is there on top, into that area we put crystals of pyrogalol and sodium hydroxide. What happens here is that under the alkaline conditions provided by sodium hydroxide, pyrogalol will react with whatever oxygen is present to form water. Additionally, we stopper this tube with the help of a rubber stopper to make sure that no oxygen gets inside. So this is also a common method that can be used in labs for growth of anaerobes. So what we have spoken about today are the different mechanisms for cultivation of anaerobes, the major ones being the use of a gas packed jar for the incubation and use of anaerobic chamber for the inoculation. Apart from that, we also have phosphorus stick method, roll tube method and pyrogalol method, which can be used for the growth of anaerobic organisms, or in other words, organisms that cannot tolerate even a little bit of oxygen. I hope today's class was useful for you all, and I hope to see you in the next class. Thank you.